Namaskar and a very warm welcome to everyone joined in today on our 14th Know Your Species, Know Your Zoo talk. This talk is being organized by the Central Zoo Authority, New Delhi, as part of the ongoing Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. The Mahotsav is a 75-week-long celebration to commemorate 75 years of India's independence, which falls on the 15th of August 2022. The Central Zoo Authority is taking the celebration forward through a massive outreach campaign entitled Conservation to Coexistence, The People Connect. Under the helm of this campaign, we will be showcasing 75 conservation priority species and 75 zoos, highlighting one species and one zoo each week. We are currently in week 14 of the celebration with the Dhol as the species in focus and the Indira Gandhi Zoological Park as the zoo in focus. Joined in today to speak to us on the species is Dr. Bhaskar Acharya. Dr. Bhaskar is an independent wildlife consultant with over 2 decades of experience in different areas of conservation science. He began his research on dholes in Kanha Tiger Reserve, which succeeded into a 7-year study in Painch Tiger Reserve on the ecology of the dholes using radio collar. In addition to canid biology, he is also interested in wild ungulate ecology, plant taxonomy, and insect-plant interactions. Dr. Bhaskar is a member of the IUCN Canid Specialist Group, which compiles and disseminates information on the conservation and status of all canid species across their range. He will speak to us today on the species in focus and the challenges it faces in wild. Over to you, sir.
Okay, give me time to share the content. Can all of you see this?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Can I start?
Yes, please start.
Okay, the species in focus today is a dhol, otherwise called the Asiatic wild dog, the whistling dog, the red dog, Chennai, Kennai, based on which language it is, Son Kutta or Ban Kutta, Jangli Kutta, throughout the range in India, across the world, in different places they call different names, but these are the common names that they're known by. And how do they evolve? Basically, those evolved as canids and they separated from the common domestic dog and the gray wolf around 4 million years ago. And the closest relative is the, evolutionarily looking at it, is the African wild dog, with which it has got a lot of similarities also. So what is a dhol? What does it look like? What's the characteristic of a dhol? It looks like any dog, any canid, but if you see, the color of the skin is, the fur is more reddish brown, and typically the whole underside and the inner side of the limbs are all white. Yeah, it has a very broad and short muzzle, unlike a dog, very pointed and rounded ears, and the tail is, unlike a domestic dog, it's not curled around, or it's always straight, and sometimes it's a darker color than the body. Sometimes there is a typical white tip, which is probably the very few identification marks for individuals that we can use, because dholes as a member of the species are extremely very similar looking animals. They don't have any distinct color markings that you can distinguish them. In field, we use things like, scars or distinctive marks. In Pench, there used to be one female dhole without a tail, so she used to be easily spotted. So these are the remarkable characters that we can use in an otherwise very similar looking animal. So it takes a long time to distinguish between individuals. Sometimes the size may vary, and there may be other patterns that we can use. And what else? They are a very social, extremely social pack living animals, very similar to the wolves, but in the case of wolves, it usually is a family pack. All individuals are usually close related. Whereas in a dhol pack, there may be really unrelated individuals who have joined the pack. And the pack is not a very constant unit. There'll be an alpha male, alpha female, and sometimes the young ones, and sometimes uncles, and sometimes, people who have other dholes that have come and, in a friendly way, joined the group. And at some point of time, they might all disperse and break up for a variety of reasons. And they're very social, extremely, they have their own hierarchies, but they still are very social, cuddling against each other all the time. They don't believe in social distancing at all. So you, this is normally when you see a pack of wild dogs, you can, especially during the monsoon time where they're not in a hurry to go anywhere, you can see them lolling in the grass and playing around. And it's a good time to watch them. And this is a visual of adult dog, maybe the parent or the relative, regurgitating food to the pups, you know, from a hunt. And how are they different in terms of genetics from a common familiar and canis familiaris, the domestic dog, is that they have one molar less on the lower jaw compared to wolves and domestic dogs. And also the number of the teeth are also much more numerous than dogs, because they are capable of the highest number of the largest litter recorded till now has been 12 pups at one time. The pug mark is very similar to the dog. It's not very difficult to distinguish unless you are, you know, where you're located. Sometimes a large dog maybe, and the wolf pug mark is slightly bigger than the wolf pug mark. And one of the characteristics of the, like all other canids, is this scent marking or territorial marking where they defecate on certain places that are barren patches. It may be related to territorialism. We still have not yet found out whether they're actually marking boundaries of territories, or if there's any way in which that, you know, they're using it to delineate areas. Then a very particular thing why they call whistling dogs is because they have this very strange whistling sound that travels quite a few kilometers away. This is very rarely used, but is used to locate and regroup, basically when they have other auditory signs like yelps and yaps and barks, small bark. They don't have a true bark, but they have a lot of other vocalizations. But this particular whistling is used only for regrouping and trying to contact other members of the pack. So that's why they're called whistling dogs. And another very strange thing, they are excellent swimmers, and they're very strong swimmers. They are, and many of the hunts actually end in water, in a pond or a river or a stream. And this invariably, we think, you know, when we see the prey going into the water, we know that's finished, because the dog is a better, the dole is a better swimmer. So sometimes it's just a single dog that kills a prey and takes it all the way swimming across to the banks where the remaining members of the pack feed on the carcass. And one very important part of the dog is the in terms of communication, is the tail, because a lot of behavioral studies can be done on the attitude, the mood, and the what the dog is trying to convey by looking at the tail of the dog and how it holds it. Where do you get to see the doles? They are present almost all over peninsular India, except the drier parts. They are also found in mountainous forested regions throughout the Himalayas, all the way to Southeast Asia and South and Southeast Asia. The reason why they are not found in the drier regions is because of extremely dependent on water, as much as the tigers. You see, and a lot of them, a lot of the range overlaps with the tiger. And there are instances where even places like the Aravallis, the Sariska and Ranthambore once had doles, and they'll probably come back if there's some connectivity. Now, recently they found a camera trapped picture of a dole in Gujarat. So there is no place that you can say they'll not turn up with, but once upon a time they were also found in Rajasthan. And what forms a dole habitat? It could be any forest with enough prey in it. They're not very dependent on the actual the density of the vegetation or the tree. It's more to do with the prey habit, the prey availability, the lack of disturbance, or the lesser the disturbance, the more favorable for the dole. And one major factor is, you know, rivers or lakes or ponds or water sources, because as you all know, doles love water, and that's kind of a limiting factor. You don't really find doles in places where they do not have access to water, especially during the denning season. And what are dole dens? They look something like this. This used to be a former natal den. And they have other dens also. For example, if they're disturbed in the natal den, they might even go to a temporary den, which they use only for, you know, as a stopgap arrangement for shelter against, you know, other co-predators. And how we started our work on doles was when we captured three individuals data them, immobilize them, then radio collar them, and then release them back into the habitat. And we tracked them on foot, on from vehicle as much as we could, and we actually took location only when we saw them. So based on that research, we found out that a Dole PAX range, basically this is one individual in each pack was radio tagged. A pack range can vary from anywhere from 64 square kilometers to 200 square kilometers, depending on how they move, what their territory is, where they, what they find is a suitable habitat. And within a season also, there can be a lot of variations based on how they move around in the habitat. And now looking at feeding ecology of the doles, how do you find out what it is that the doles feed on most or what they prefer most? One way to do it is to get, in terms of numbers of data we can get, is to look at scats. We collect scats at regular intervals spaced at a distance, and this is what a dole scat looks like. And then this is washed, dried, the remains of fecal fecal matter is washed away, and the hair and other bony matter is retained. And under the microscope, we analyze, you know, because we have a key of what prey hair looks like. And based on that, we identify what prey is fed on by the dole. But a better way is to look at dole kills, if we can see them. You can do that only if you track them on a very continuous way, you know. Sometimes with the radio tracking becomes easy because we can just follow them, track them, and go and locate the kill. And now with GPS collars, it's even better to locate them. But kills are more definitive. They give us a much more clearer picture of actually whether the doles have killed them or whether they have taken over some other prey, some other predator's kill, what they're feeding on, or what they may be coming back to the same kill. So there's a particular way we can track what they're feeding on. This is a much better indicator of feeding ecology. And what we do with the kill, once the dogs have, once those have left, we go measure the remains to see how much is, we do subtract and find out how much meat, we estimate how much would have been eaten by the prey. They usually don't eat the rumen, but it's the meat of the rump that they like. What is the ideal, what is the favorite species of dole prey, as usual, for all carnivores, the preferred prey in the Indian forest is the sambar deer. Like what in the previous talk Bilal said, Dr. John Singh said, everybody is saying the same thing. Sambar is one of the best prey species for all predators. And sambar also is a very good indicator of the habitat. It shows that the habitat has very good vegetation, very good biomass for the prey to consume, and an indicator that it's a lesser disturbance from human factors. So as much as sambar is an indicator of good habitat, it's one of the key elements of a habitat for a predator. And the same goes for doles. I'm sure Dr. Johnson will also say, no, sambar conservation is dole conservation. And the more numerous prey, where in terms of numbers and in terms of actual availability for doles, is the cheetal or the spotted deer. I mean, throughout its range, and spotted deer is also favored in a lot of national parks in more open country. So you get to see, in terms of, you know, scats and kills, we tend to see more of cheetal because they're more numerous. Whereas the sambar is much more of a forested, inland kind of a species. But in terms of preference, the doles will always go for a sambar. Other prey species is the wild pig, and especially the young ones are really favored. But a wild pig is a very dangerous prey for doles because the males and some of the large females are very vicious. They can attack. It's up to a big pack how experienced they are to kill a wild pig and make a meal out of it. And we have found remains of Nilgai also and doles cats. The same is true for gaur. It's probably young gaur they might have fed on or may have scavenged, but we have seen wild dog packs troubling dole, troubling gaur herds, and troubling all animals. In fact, they will, for them, everything is game, like they say, you know, they'll play around. Even if they're not hungry, sometimes they go and try to make a mock attack, something like a practice session, you know, how they learn to hunt, how they teach the young ones how to deal with a difficult prey, you know, how they to stay away from the kicks of the prey species, how to do this. They may be doing that, but if they get a chance, they will feed on gaur too. And langurs and maybe even macaques, when they're available and they're ground and they're outwitted, they might actually make a prey of them. We have found remains of langur, hare, and peafowl and the scat of wild dogs. We don't know if they were scavenged up and hunted. So the remains are still there on the list of prey, but a major, or rather say a very minor prey species of those. In terms of denning, and in terms of we look at the behavior, den is the best place to observe doe behavior. Unfortunately, we do not have any of our collared pack dens, and we did not find any active den because we didn't have a history, unlike Mudumalai or Bandipur or places where there are a history of people who have been following does. We had to start from scratch to look at, ask people around. Not many people knew about dens, and when they pointed us to dens, they seemed to be not, there used to be postnatal dens. And the radio collared animals also did not really, we had one pair that we thought they bred, but they did not have pups. So we don't have enough information about denning and pup behavior and other things. This is what a den looks like. This was not used when we took the picture. This is a former den. And pups look like this. This is a captive pups. Someone once described them as russet balls of fur. Very apt, actually. And this is about for a month from, those usually breed in October. That's the month when most of the Indian subcontinent, you have, that's a breeding season of those. Only an alpha male and alpha female breed. And in and around New Year, that is December, either on 31st of December, 1st of January or 2nd, around this time, they give birth to pups. It's about 60 to 63 days of gestation. And the pups are born blind. They take some time to get used to. Then they come out very rarely, except the second or third week, they're out. They're brought out to sun and then taken back. This is about a month old pup. And they are now slowly getting acclimatized, moving around with the pack. They don't move too far from the den. But by the second month, around end of February, they're out of the den. They don't stay there anymore. And they're out on the hunt. They're on the fringe of the, when the pack is hunting, they're usually on the fringes and they join up when the kill is done. That's when they whistle and call them to come to the hunt. For security reasons, they're kept at the out. And there'll be a couple of nurse, we call them aunts or uncles of the actual main pack, main pair that will actually be looking after the pups. And the same thing in those is some of them may not even be related genetically to them. That's why they're called cooperative breeders. The main competitors to those are, in terms of resource competition, tigers definitely. And in terms of, because they both, tigers and does prefer sambar and large cheetal to kill. And in terms of actual encounters, we haven't had any sightings, but a lot of videos are now coming because from tourists and from other researchers. There are encounters. It usually depends on the pack size versus the tiger. Or sometimes the tiger has been, there are videos of tigers attacking does. And there are very few incidents of does attacking lions. There are stories of does attacking tigers, but not many. Nowadays, we get a lot of videos of tigers with does. Then another, the major competitor for the does and the ones they hate each other is the leopard and the does. Any encounter is usually very vicious. If it's a single doe, that leopard will ensure that it kills the doe. If it's more than one doe, it's a pair, the does have an upper hand, and the leopards usually are treed. They run up the tree and wait there as and when the does release them. And those sometimes we saw a pair, a collared pair that sat under a tree for nearly a day, not feeding, not doing anything, just because the leopard was on top of the tree. So that's how much of enmity they have got. It's also because a lot of, just not just a competition, but actually in terms of, the encounters between them are usually very, extremely vicious. And another new threat, and it's always been there, but there's a current increasing threat is domestic dogs. Not just domestic dogs, even feral dogs. And many of the fringes of the forest, domestic dogs have become feral. They form their own loose packs. They attack a lot of wild animals that stray out. They are a threat. In terms of encounters between dogs and those, we have seen some encounters of village dogs, but usually the numbers matter. If the and it's a chase, basically, the numbers matter. Whichever number is larger, whichever group is larger, they chase away the others. So in terms of interactions and in terms of actual prey, a lot of dole remains are lost to domestic dogs. Another feature is that there's a lot of times that humans follow these feral dogs in search of, how to take over a kill from doles, because once a human appears there, the doles disappear. The one creature they are afraid of, they're actually afraid of, is the human, which comes to the main threat to doles, which is humans. And then you can't really say humans per se, because in many of the doles range, the indigenous people have learned to live with doles, and doles have managed with them. They are not, we have had one radio collared dole that actually traveled through a village without being detected, because they know how to deal with humans. In terms of humans perceiving doles as threats, in very few, especially in the Northeast, they have some cases of the suspected Mithun being predated by doles. But otherwise, the rest of the range, very few cases of cattle or livestock or goats being predated by doles, essentially because doles don't venture into human habitations. And second is because usually there's a human accompanying this, so those stay very far away from, they move away whenever they see a single human. Even if there's a large pack, they move away from humans. So to an extent, that indicates that presence of human is actually a threat for wild dogs. Next, we look at what's the road ahead for those. You know, so in terms of conservation, they've got in a way, it's an upgrade. They've become, from being called vulnerable, now they're now got to a status they're endangered, which means a lot of funding is going to be available for them for research on doles, for conservation of doles, which wasn't there during my time. So it's a good thing that the recognition is there that by the global and the national governments that a dole is quite an endangered species. The numbers are reducing. We don't have very good estimates because they're not a priority species for regular monitoring. So now a lot of camera trap information is coming, so which there is a group of people who are actually looking at looking at demography of those and seeing where they are doing well, where they are not, and where the population and conservation has to be augmented, which are the regions, which are the places where they are going to be. The risk of extinction is high, where a lot of conservation can be concentrated on. And coming to who's working on doles in the wild, we have this one group of Pallavi is a very fascinating young lady who's doing some wonderful work in Central India, in Taroba in particular, under the supervision of Bilal Habib from Wildlife Institute of India. And they have GPS collared doles, so which is a very much better improvement over radio collared doles. And this gives much finer information, much more data, with a lot of activity information coming from it. And I think they're planning to call out 10 more. There should be actually there's much more, because we need more data and more numbers in terms of sample size to come at robust figures for a lot of features that doles are known or researched for. Another group is the Wild Canids India Project, which is part of the WCS program, and there's this one young guy called Arjun Sivatsa who's fascinated with those, doing his PhD also on those. He's completed his PhD on those, and he has other researchers like Girish Punjabi, who worked on the northern western ghats to those, which were not really looked at earlier. So this group of young researchers are actually documenting a lot of wild canids in the country, and with special emphasis on doles. So we see a lot of outputs going to be coming from them. And then this is the giants. They're the ones, Kripakar and Senani, who have been filming wild dogs for nearly 30 years, and they know doles and all of us, all researchers put together. And they've been with doles. They're the film on doles won the Wild Dog Diaries has won several national and international awards, and there's not, we say there's nothing they do not know about those. And they've been with those, they've seen with them, they've interacted with them. In terms of not hours, you talk of years of information they've got about those. So these are the people that the rest of the anybody who's viewing this video should actually be trying to contact to know more about the DOLs and to see if they can join up with the project, in what way they can, you know, contribute to the research and conservation of DOLs in the wild, if they're really interested. And the anecdotes, the kind of incidents, the kind of queries that this group of people can answer is going to be phenomenal. So with this, I'm ending my talk.
Thank you, sir, for the enlightening talk on DOLs and the research that's been carried forward as of today. I would request you to stop sharing screen now. And we move on to the second part of the session, which is on Know Your Zoo. So join in today to speak to us on the zoo is Dr. Nandini Silaria. Dr. Nandini is an officer of the Indian Forest Service 2013 batch. She's a veterinarian by training and has done a diploma in forestry and a postgraduate diploma in advanced wildlife management. She has been awarded various accolades throughout her academic and professional career, and has a decade experience in wildlife welfare and management. Her other areas of research lie in eco-development, sustainable livelihood generation, climate change policy formulation and mitigation, implementation, management, and management of captive animals. She has worked under different capacities with the government of Andhra Pradesh and currently serves as the curator of the Indira Gandhi Zoological Park. She will speak to us today on the zoo, its vision, and its accomplishments. Over to you.
Thank you, Ms. Arundhati, for your kind words. Good afternoon, everyone. Firstly, thank you, Dr. Bhaskar, for such an enlightening talk, such an interesting talk, very simply put through. Thank you very much. It was very enlightening indeed. So I shall start with my presentation. As already introduced, I am curator of Indira Gandhi Zoological Park, Visakhapatnam, which is in the state of Andhra Pradesh. And yeah, I would be sharing my screen. Yes, Arundhati, please let me know if you are able to see my slides on power.
Yes, it's visible, ma'am.
Yeah? Okay, yeah. Right. So, yes. So, Indira Gandhi Zoological Park, Visakhapatnam. Firstly, I would say that we are really thankful to CZA, Central Zoo Authority, and the Government of India for starting this program called Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, which is a very unique idea and a very unique initiative in the way that, I mean, this is a very unique way of celebrating 75 years of Indian independence, that where we are already starting since March, that every week we are celebrating each species which are there in different areas of Indian forests as well as Indian zoos. So, and also, I mean, through Central Zoo Authority, the Indian zoos which have been given this opportunity of highlighting the work they are doing, as well as linking to the in situ conservation initiatives which are ongoing, which is a very, very important need of the hour, which I personally believe, because the importance of the zoos have to be highlighted, where we are seeing the current scenario where more and more species are getting endangered and in the verge of getting vulnerable or extinction or rare, whatever categories we may put them in. So in such a scenario, I think the role of zoos, rather than just picnic spots for the visitors, we need to create much, much more awareness activities so that they understand that we do much more than just the picnics or the sightings of the wild animals in the enclosures. So I think it's a great initiative where we are celebrating each and every species, and where we get to celebrate this species dhol, which has become my favorite after coming here. I mean, it was one of the favorites, but it has become more favorite after coming to IGZP, as we are taking up the conservation breeding project. So yeah, without taking much more time, I would start on my presentation about Vizag Zoo. So let me start with the location. It's a large zoo, so situated almost in the eastern Ghats of the country. And it is actually located in the Sitakonda Reserve Forest of Visakhapatnam district. which is actually a very, very unique location in the way that the Eastern Ghats, which is of a forest and a hilly ecosystem, is meeting into the Bay of Bengal. And I guess there is nowhere, as per my knowledge, there is no other zoo in the country which has this much shortest ever distance between this kind of the unique forest ecosystem and the marine ecosystem. So entirely, it's a unique feature for this zoo. And about the history, the zoo came into existence in 1972 and it was opened to the public in 1977. So almost it's a decade, it's half a decade old. And it's also a third largest zoo in the country in terms of area. It is situated in the coastal city of Vizag. So yes, it is very, very easily accessible to local, regional and international visitors, which again adds the value to the zoo. So if I talk about the location and the area details, it's actually entirely hilly terrain where we have an area of 625 acres, but the built up area is only 250 acres. I would be telling you why. And we also have an additional 23 acres of marine land complex, which you can see here right at the bottom. I mean, on the right side here, the marine land complex is there, which is right next to the beach. So on the other side, if you see of the zoo park, there's Kambal Konda Eco Park, which is actually a part of Kambal Konda Wildlife Sanctuary. These two areas, the zoo park and the Kambal Konda Wildlife Sanctuary, are being divided by a national highway. And we also have a animal rescue center, which is around 62.5 acres on the other side of the highway, which is also under our control. So overall, if we look at it, we are looking at a much larger landscape than just a zoo in an urban landscape. So about the vision and objectives, if I speak, we are actually envisioning to develop self-sustaining, genetically and behaviorally viable populations of endangered animal species in order to use them as an ex situ gene pool in the long-term conservation of these species. This may all sound very technically jargoned, but yeah, that's the vision which the zoo is looking for. And also to seek the support of visitors and public at large through participation in these efforts of wildlife conservation, which I personally believe is very, very important and is one of the strong pillars of the zoo management as such. So yeah, if I talk about the objectives of the zoo as such, the prime most objective is about ex situ conservation of critically endangered fauna. And also to become a leader in ex situ conservation breeding and research. Also to propagate the value of wildlife and its conservation through education and interpretation, as I said, being very, very important. And also to become self-sufficient and number one in captive veterinary care and facilities, while also becoming best sustainable and green public place in the country, and yet finally becoming the most preferred destination. So yeah, that's a big dream, but certainly we will make it true very, very soon is what we are hoping for. So yeah, this is for interpretation purpose. This is a layout map. I mean, this is just a map of zoo, not really the layout. But yeah, this is how the zoo looks like. On the top side there is a highway, and the other side there is the beach, the sea. So yeah, this is how it is. And as I said, that zoo, even though has a area of around 625 acres, but the built up area is only 250 acres, because it is mainly the area is covered by hills, mainly two hills with steep slopes and a valley. And thus it leaves just around 200 acres of area in the center, and also some another pocket on the northern side of 75 acres. So we are just left with 275 acres, out of which we have utilized around 250 acres area for the zoo. So overall, if you look at it, to put things in perspective, it is a very, very naturalistic zoo. I mean, you don't feel like you are in the middle of a city after you enter this zoo. So to put things more into perspective, this is what I was talking about, the landscape, where on the left of the highway you see the Kambal Konda Wildlife Sanctuary, and on the right you see portion of the zoo. Also, this is also another area where we can see the developed area inside the zoo. These are the enclosures somewhere. And talking about the land use area of the zoo, if we look at it, this peach color area or the orange color area, whatever you may call it, it's around forest. This area is forest. So the major portion of the zoo area is occupied by forest, and also this the mustard color portion. If you see the open forest category, which is also around 51.4 hectare. So the major portion is around the forest area. So it's a very very naturalistic enclosure, having a very natural feel. The enclosures form only 27.55 hectare area, but I must say the enclosures are yet very very big for each and every species. So I will also give you a glimpse of that as well. So so if you see this enclosure here, there is a standoff barrier. You can see some people standing, and this is the enclosure for the saltwater crocodile. So if you could not see the saltwater crocodile in this yet, I would like to show you that. So that's just a zoom in of that picture. If you see this, yeah. So here it is. So that's how our enclosures look like, you know. They're very, very naturalistic. We have tried to make them as close to the natural habitat of the particular species as possible. So that's how it is. And also the zoo has a lot of reservoirs, a lot of areas where it forms habitats for migratory birds. And a lot of heroneries are there, where there are big, big ficus trees, which are really act as a big habitat in itself. So this is one of our, this is our one portion of our elephant enclosure, where you can see some two elephants also standing. So to look at the perspective of the things we are looking at, it's quite a big enclosure. And this, I can say, is only 1/5 of the enclosure as such. This is a giraffe enclosure. So, I mean, I'm just showing these two so that at least people get, those who have not seen the zoo, the Vizag Zoo, they get a perspective of how things are in the zoo and how it looks like, so that the following slides make sense for them. So coming to the administration, the organization chart of the zoo, the director or the curator, which is myself, I'm heading the zoo. And I have a team of two assistant curators who are the range officer, forest range officers. And we also have a veterinary assistant surgeon who is a rank of assistant director. And he's assisted by a junior veterinarian and also his veterinary assistants. And also the office staff, superintendent, and other things. So, but about the animal keepers, I would say that we have the maximum vacancies in that section. And mostly we are, the animal keeping is run through outsourcing, which is again a challenge for us, but yet our outsourcing staff is also doing a great job. So this is one of the glimpses of our admin building and the hospital. This is a feed store. Yeah, this is something which we have developed over the last year, and in two places where we could develop this area in the span of 2 to 4 months, where we are now able to produce our own green fodder and also some fruits and vegetables for the animals of the zoo. So that, because the pandemic has shown us new challenges. Already the zoo was having so many challenges, but pandemic has given us many more challenges to face. And so this was another challenge, that the feed which is coming from outside could be infected, and how far we are able to disinfect it. Fruits and vegetables are just fine, but how do you disinfect the grasses anyways? So these kind of challenges, and anyways it is economical to produce your own fodder. So this was something which we started last year, and we are happy that we are able to sustain it till now, and it is actually growing now. We have expanded this activity to another plot, so it's growing well. So about the animal world, we have as on date we have around 88 species of different categories. Like carnivores, we have around 10 species, totaling to around 90 animals, which includes Royal Bengal tiger, white tiger, leopards, dholes, then striped hyena, Asiatic lion, and other species. Then also the herbivores, we have almost all the deers and many more species which we are not having, but they're in our collection plan. We are trying to get through animal exchange programs. Primates, rodents, reptiles, and apes. So yeah, this is a collage of our animal collection probably, and some glimpse of our animals. The mega herbivores like hippopotamus or elephant, rhino, giraffe, are there. Even species like zebra, they are there. Exotics like sacred baboon, chimpanzee, ring-tailed lemur are there. Also the native species like rhesus macaque and other macaques are also there. We also have common marmoset in the exotic primates. Regarding the carnivores, as already said, birds also, we have a huge variety of species, and we are trying to get more of indigenous species in our collection. Reptiles also, apart from the crocodiles like mugger, saltwater, gharials, we are also having type of serpentarium where we are housing the rat snakes, the cobras, rock pythons, green iguanas. They're all in open moat enclosures, which is one of the unique features of the serpentarium or the herpetarium of the zoo, Vizag Zoo. So we also have a butterfly park, which houses butterflies both inside and outside. And this is another, the bottom picture is of a rearing unit. We have started recently rearing of butterflies. And also we are trying to go as far as eco-friendly as possible. And the milk packets which we receive in our feed store, we get those milk packets, and our butterfly park assistant, and with her team, they make sure that these packets are being used for raising the plants, the host and nectar species for the butterflies, and we give them as giveaways to our to our participants in the butterfly workshops. So that's how it goes, and we've also started rearing. As you can see, even we are using the old used bottles with some holes and everything in for rearing. So small initiatives, but yes, it makes a lot of difference. So yes, when we're talking about animal, I think enrichment is something which is very, very important. When it comes to zoo, there are three stakeholders which I believe are very, very important, and I think that's these three only, they form the crux of the zoo management. First is the animals, second is the keeper, and third is the visitor. So once the animal is happy, the keeper would be happy and he would be able to perform his job properly. Also, the visitor will also feel happy to see an animal in a happy place and a happy mood. So ultimately, we strongly believe that animal enrichment creates a win-win situation for the three stakeholders of the zoo. So every day we are on a move to create more and more enrichments for our animals. So whether it is creating some or the other kind of machans, or including some dead trees, and putting some old used tires into some kind of toy for the animals, it could be anything. So our biologist and his team is always on a go to make some more and more enrichment tools for the animals. So also with respect to the seasonal arrangement, especially now since it is summer going on, we have always been keen on the animal care for providing its best facilities during this season. Especially it's like auto-tuned for the staff here. Once there is a hint that, okay, it's summers are heating up, okay, everybody starts the activity. Before itself, we tune it. So there are a lot of things like the palmara leaf huts are there. We put on the sprinklers, we put on the AC air coolers and fans for the animals inside the night houses also. Put these khaskhas mats and the sprinkling of water on them on the morning and evening. A lot of things are there. So these things form part of the basis for the animal to be happy in the enclosure as well as in the day crawl, wherever it is housed. So when it comes to animal, it comes to veterinary, it is very, very mandatory to have a very good veterinary team and to have good facilities in the zoo hospital so that all the animals are being treated on time and properly. So we are already equipped with a post-mortem room, the OT room or surgical room, x-ray facility, squeeze cages, indoor patient ward, quarantine ward, isolation ward, and other kind of library and pathological laboratory is also there, which helps us in diagnosis of many parasitic and other diseases in case there are any, and also the tranquilizing equipment and drugs. This is something which we are working on a regular basis to improvise upon. Last year also we brought many new equipments of tranquilization and the new drugs also. So, and even the stainless steel cages we have taken, so we have purchased so that which could be used for the treatment of the animals, and it actually came very, very handy for the veterinary team. So yeah, these are some of the pictures from the veterinary hospital. We have most of the facilities, but we are working to make it even better. So hand rearing of newborns in IGZP is something I think, it's something which we have excelled over the period of time. This started with a striped hyena, one female who was showing a stereotypic behavior where she was not taking care of the newborns, or she was harming them. So that's where we started intervening, and our veterinary team is now trained enough to rear many. They have reared, actually hand reared many newborns, and they are very, very good raised animals as on date. So yeah, this is something which we have excelled upon. Now about the conservation breeding, as I said, the most important objective of the zoo, the conservation, the ex situ conservation breeding of the critically endangered species of wildlife is something which we are looking at very, very with lot of concern. And CZA has already recognized IGZP as a coordinating zoo for the Asiatic wild dog, which has been breeding very well for past many years now in the zoo, which actually started with the accident which I described the other day during the workshop, during the session. So yeah, today we have a population of 39, and we have very proudly through animal exchange programs given these animals to many other Indian zoos, and also with some foreign zoos also, where they are breeding very well. And we are proud that we have been able to achieve the objective of ex situ conservation through at least this way. So yeah, but certainly because the Vizag Zoo provides best climatic factors to support conservation breeding of various species, so it certainly has potential to expand the conservation breeding for various other species as well, especially from the Eastern Ghats or even any other species of national or international conservation efforts. So we are generally very good at breeding canids, wild dogs, striped hyena, jackals have been bred here very, very, have a good record. Also, since we have a very strategic location where we are just close to the beach, I think it just offers us opportunity to initiate some kind of recovery programs for marine animals, whether it could be, whether we could just start with some olive ridley turtles, which is something we've been thinking upon. But yeah, this is something which we can dwell upon and formulate a strategy. Also, we have been, the herbivores like Indian gaur have also been breeding very well, and sambar, including sambar. And also these actually, Vizag Zoo can serve as a breeding center in future for these species, including swamp deer, foehorned antelope, chausinga, sambar deer, Indian gaur, for further release and replenishment in the protected areas, which is very, very essential to maintain a prey base. So yeah, these are some of the pictures of our wild dogs. Statistical data of our dole breeding in IGZP, which shows that of course there has been an increase since the intervention was taken. And this is the Wild Dog Conservation Breeding Center. Looks like it's an off-display facility, which is surrounded by hillocks, and there is no human in disturbance in this area. Some of the pictures from the center. So as I said, a lot of other species, including the indigenous as well as the exotics like the ring-tailed lemo, are also breeding very well, even including the black swans. And yes, so that's how even the reptiles are breeding very well. Recently also we had hatchlings from green iguanas and from mugger. So I think we've spoken about the major stakeholder in zoo, that's the animals, and the second stakeholder is the visitor. So coming to that, we have a good amount of facilities in the zoo for the visitors for the visitors. So we have a bioscope where it has a capacity of 250 students, and we keep on carrying out some of the other activities. We have an annual visitation of around 9 lakhs, and we do intend to increase it to 15 lakhs by creating more and more awareness and also bringing more and more attractive ways to invite the visitors to the zoo. So almost every month we have around 3 to 4 events going on, whether during this pandemic now it has mostly taken the form of online, but otherwise it's generally involving the students and the college students and the public from in and around the Vizag city. So generally it's a very happening place, but because of Corona since past 2 years, everything has been happening online. So yeah, still it's happening, but online. So since the ticket rates are very, very nominal, I would say, the zoo revenue is generally in a normal situation, it is around 4.12 crores like that. But yeah, yes, last year and this year, we are still in, losses because of the pandemic, as everybody is. So yeah, these are some of the facilities. We are trying hard to provide as eco-friendly alternatives for the visitors as possible. And yes, the bio toilets or even the plastics, we keep a security and we give them the cloth bags. Those are their public Wi-Fi. This is a bioscope. It may not look very beautiful, but yes, it does contain a lot of information, and it will certainly look more, much, much more beautiful in the coming days. So yeah, these are the pictures from previous years where a lot of children used to come, and some pictures from the last year where we had taken some activities, the zoo run or some painting competitions. So these are some of the initiatives, butterfly walk and the bird walk series, which we started last year, and it had received good response, as in few participants, I would say. But the ones, they actually got a window to explore their interest in the wildlife. So yeah, these kind of activities do bring a lot of interest in the public around. And as you can see in this picture, there are people from old age, like people from the age of 70 to 10 years or 5 years used to come for our bird walks and the butterfly walks. So we are having some dedicated groups called of volunteers and the bird watching groups for these activities. So the conservation education, as I said, is very, very important. It doesn't end at just our activities. It also goes on our walls also and the buildings and everywhere. So we try to be as informative as possible. And we are trying to be as eco-friendly as possible. We have started the e-bikes this year, March only. And soon we are going to have the installation of solar rooftop also in the zoo, which has already been approved by our PCCF, sir. And yes, some more facilities for souvenir and outreach center. Some really eco-friendly products like bamboo toothbrush, some organic soaps, seed pencils, seed pens, all these kind of products which we are now offering to our visitors. Now we have talked about the two major stakeholders. The third one comes the animal keepers or our staff who's involved in the zoo. So something which is very, very important, including insurance and taking care of their regular salaries and everything, is their health checkup and the vaccination in the view of pandemic. So this is something very, very regular in the zoo. And we ensure that the women, in fact, on the Women's Day, we had this pap test done for the women employees. So we ensure that we are updated with the health status of our keepers and the staff in the zoo, so that they are also aware of what is going on in their body. And it's very, very important since they are in an interface of human-wildlife interface where there could be, transmission of many zoonotic diseases from and vice versa. So also, the capacity building of our staff is something which we always look forward to. And given this opportunity by CZA to us in the form of this national level keepers training, which was another first for us as well as for the country, I think, where we have dedicatedly done an online or a hybrid mode of training for the keepers, which was actually very, very challenging. But yes, we could do it quite well, I guess. And it was a first of its kind that it was dedicated to the captive management of reptiles, and Dr. Gauri was a resource person, and we had the huge support from CZA and the team. So this is something, the capacity building, which we are looking forward. Now, since we have talked about zoo, I would talk about Animal Rescue Center, which is another important branch of our zoo. It's on the other side of the highway, and where we have kept our circus rescued lions and tigers. And now they're left, only few are left, but the Animal Rescue Center is generally also being used for the rescue operations of housing the rescued animals from other adjacent districts also, right from pangolin to the python to civet cats and other parakeets or other birds. We've been rescuing a lot of animals. The zoo team is actually always ahead in doing all these kind of animal rescues. Yes, for visitors and for all the animal lovers in the state or in the country, we have also started this animal adoption scheme, and many animal lovers are coming forward. So yeah, this is our animal adoption chart. And yes, whatever keeps happening in the zoo is always in the media, and it's very good to see that media is very, very interested in the city of Vizag, in the zoo, in what is going on inside the zoo. And it's, they're always very understanding, and it's very, very interesting how they develop opinions and how we make them understand about certain things and how they show interest in the activities of the zoo. So zoo is always on a highlight in the city of Vizag. So it's even more important for us to update the media on a regular basis. So some of our best practices, I think, and these are just our strength and opportunities, which just forms the basis. A recent development as an initiative of CZA through the vision plan, which was being developed, we have started a collaboration with Parco Natura Viva Italy with the support of CZA. And these are the areas which we are looking forward to collaborate with them. And it is pertinent to mention that the devastation which IGZP had encountered or faced due to the Hudhud cyclone in 2014, and these are just few pictures where I'm showing the devastation, the level of devastation it had encountered or faced, and the kind of pictures I've shown you all through by now, I think you can understand the kind of effort my predecessors, the previous curators or the conservators or all the officers who are involved and the staff of the zoo, as well as the volunteers from the Vizag district have put in so much hard work to bring the zoo to this level where it is now. So it's a huge, achievement as such. Also, because of this Hudhud cyclone, the APDRP, the Andhra Pradesh Disaster Recovery Project, was started. Which is a World Bank funded project where not only some standalone works could be done, but also the formation of a 10-year master plan and some detailed project reports for the redevelopment and restoration of IGZP to a worth of around 56 crores has already been prepared. And because of the lack of funding as of the present state, we could not ground the works. As and when we receive the funding, we would be able to do it. But the standalone works which could be done under this project, it is very, very important to mention that as well, where we could make a protection wall for elephant moat. So these were big works which we could ground in the previous year, and some construction of primate night houses for the ringtail lemurs. The previous houses were not very well ventilated, and they lacked the ventilation and proper sunlight. So the new very spacious night houses have been made for primate species. Also, we have been able to repair our roads. So that's how we could actually promote this activity of e-bikes. And also, as I said earlier, we have been procuring goods for our veterinary hospital and also the feed distribution vehicle. This has all been done under APDRP. So yeah, about the future plans for the IGZP, actually based on a note given to the cabinet meeting, the government of Andhra Pradesh has already in principle approved for modernization and upgradation of IGZP for an estimated cost of around 137 crore rupees, which would include, of course, animal enrichment, zoo visitor amenities improvement, administrative buildings and the hospital, the main entrance plaza, the new enclosures, and many more things. So these are some of the glimpses of the DPRs which are already ready, and these are our future plans. This would be our interpretation center. This is how it would look like. So right from resting shelters to the information center at the bottom, at the entrance, it would be placed. Then this would be our admin buildings. These are just the designs. I'm just showing the pictures of the designs. So this would be our interpretation center. Yes, so this is the design for an aviary. And yeah, that's it from my side. I think we still have a long way to go. But yes, the positive thing is that we are moving in the right direction is what I feel. So thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm thankful to CZA for giving us this opportunity to showcase what it is there in the YZX. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the enlightening presentation on the zoo and the future forward for it. We will now take questions and answers. So we have first questions for Dr. Bhaskar. Dr. Bhaskar, are you there?
I'm there, but yeah. I lost most of the presentation that madam made.
Oh, so it's available on our YouTube. You can view it at any point of time. There's no issue. So the first question for you, sir, is that with your experience, has the perception of the local community changed towards Dhol? And as in terms of the persecution as a pest or a livestock predator, has that reduced? And if yes, is that good news for its conservation in India?
You'll have to define what is local, because in the habitats that those are found, whether it is the indigenous people who have been living with dholes for centuries or the people who have come recently, there's a major difference in how they view dholes. Okay, so the local people don't have a problem with wild dogs at all, or dholes.
Okay.
In fact, there used to be, nowadays it doesn't happen, but Dr. John Singh's time, there used to be a lot of tribals actually benefiting from dholes, because they just have to look around for dholes and they'll find a kill and they could just take the meat. But that was long time back. Nowadays it doesn't happen. But they never had any antagonism to dholes because they never had a conflict with them. Whereas now a lot of non-forest dwellers, people who have taken over land, growing all sorts of, the conflict is mainly for people who have moved in to the forest outskirts or fringes from the cities or towns. And they come for a commercial reason, either as banana plantations or sugarcane fields or clearing land and clearing forest. That's when conflict happens. But usually in terms of, compared to tigers or leopards, we don't have cattle depredation, livestock losses to dholes. Except in the Bhutan and the Himalayan regions, they seem to have some problem, which I'm not aware of how it's coming, because it was suspected that dholes were killing mithun that were left in the forest. They have this habit where they go leave it for a duration of time and then go and bring them back. So that there used to be suspected that mithun used to be killed by dholes, but for the sense that no other predator was there. But there, the major conservation thing was, if you destroy or you kill dholes, then your wild pig population increase. So that's the kind of conservation measure people used to give to northeastern dole conflict problems. But rest of the country, there usually is no conflict with doles. The conflict is with predators as such. See, for example, the one red-eared collared animal in Kana, where I used to work, the whole pack was wiped out because they fed on a carcass that was poisoned. And the carcass was, the cattle was actually killed by leopards. So the antagonism was towards the leopards, and it was, the kill was poisoned to kill the leopard. And the wild dogs happened to eat it. So they are not targeted, and they may scavenge at this time, but they're in most of their range, they're not in direct conflict with humans.
So all right,
actually, in terms of perception of local peoples, it hasn't changed as much as before, but in terms of visitors of parks, there's a phenomenal increase in number of people who are going to parks and who seem to know what dholes are, who maybe maybe some credit should go to the zoos, and may some a lot of credit go should go to TV and internet and social media. And like I said, Kripakar and Senani, once their movie came on Discovery Channel and National Geographic, then everybody started knowing what dholes are, and they started going to parks, and parks even in paints, people started telling me, you know, there are tourists who are coming and asking to see dholes. This never was a trend before, you know, they didn't care about dholes. Now there's a, in terms of the city and the town people, there is some, a lot of more improvement and knowledge about dholes. But for the, if you turn locals, then I think for them, it's been the same. They don't have a problem with dholes.
Okay, sir. Fine. With that, we'll move to the second question. So the second question for you is that, is it possible to assess diets of dholes using more accurate and robust methods like targeted amplification of prey DNA or DNA meta barcoding?
I think prey DNA gets, I'm not a genetics person, but as far as I know, I think prey DNA gets destroyed in the digestive system. I'm not very sure of that. Maybe the WII genetics team can help you with that, or NCBS can help you with that. But it's very easy if you use GPS collars and track the kills. See, we didn't have that luxury now. And maybe I'm not sure if satellite collars will become so small that they can be used on dholes. But once you see a location where a lot of, spottings are there, then you can always go and check what was there. Usually you can locate a kill easily, much more easily using GPS and satellite collar.
Okay.
And get more based assessment. Whereas SCATS will give you, it can also include scavenged information and other kind of information. So accuracy in terms of things should be more from tracking data rather than genetic data.
Okay. All right, so the next question for you is that, are there any hybrids of dholes and domestic dogs ever being found in wild?
There have been reports in earlier chronicles, and because there could be pelage variation, maybe a jackal being mistaken for, they can have intercourse, but at the most, genetically, they are very divergent, so they cannot have fertile offsprings. And even offsprings in consumption also may be a problem. So maybe they should try something in the zoos to see if it actually happens, because there's no documented, there have been anecdotal incidences that, you know, this is a hybrid dole, jackal hybrid, or dole wolf hybrid, and dole, you know, domestic dog hybrids. But these are all old records which have not been verified. Maybe a verification in terms of scientific things is probably pending.
All right, sir. So coming to the last question for you is that, do you think there are disease crossovers between feral or domestic dogs and dholes? And what management practices do you feel should be put in place, especially in areas of overlap?
I think disease from feral dogs to not just dholes, any other carnivores is very much there. Whether it's a feline parvovirus or canine distemper, this has always been a problem, and it comes back to the same question of, you know, managing domestic and feral dogs in the outskirts of, I think there's an ATRI project that is really dealing with feral population of dogs throughout the country and what havoc they're creating there. That should be, put in a very humane way, all domestic and feral dogs in the outskirts of the forested areas of India have to be documented, have to be vaccinated, and if possible, they're maybe spayed or neutered so that the population does not increase, because they're a major problem for wildlife. And in terms of animals that are coming for rescue, they have to be a sero survey has to be done to see if they're actually susceptible to these kind of diseases. That information is very useful to have. And in terms of feral dog management in the country is a very large priority, not just for the wild areas, in terms of even zoos that are very close to the wild populations. I think it's important. I'm not very sure how close, that's a question I'm going to put to Ms. Nandini, but any population that's close to the wild population has to be vaccinated and has to be monitored regularly in different times. In terms of, for example, foot and mouth disease, there is a practice in all national parks and sanctuaries where local cattle has been vaccinated. In the same way, they should do that same thing for domestic dogs.
Okay. All right. So those were the questions for you. We now move on to questions for Dr. Nandini. So Dr. Nandini, the first question for you is that your zoo has faced a lot of many natural calamities in the past, such as cyclones. Is there a disaster management plan in place? And if it is, then can you please share some details for the benefit of the audience and other zoos?
Yes. To start with, we have faced a lot of natural calamities, and in the coming years also, it's very much susceptible because of the location. So yes, we do have a disaster management plan, which is a part of our proposed master plan as well. So yeah, probably I can share the details later with, in detail. But yes, to start with, under this project, which is APDRP, which I mentioned, what we did is all the structures which have been constructed under APDRP, they have been made with cyclone resilient material. So there are certain standards, whether it is with respect to the material, like stainless steel they will use, not the iron, because there is rusting in the iron. So they prefer using stainless steel. So that's one, that's one example. Then there is a specific standard for concrete mixture when it comes to cyclone resilience. So all these kinds of standards have been incorporated while we have made the estimates and the DPRs for the structures under APDRP. So whatever, even the modernization or the upgradation which I was talking about for IGZP, that has incorporated all these features. So all the DPRs which have been made, they have been made keeping in view that the structures are cyclone resilient. So the detailed disaster management plan is also is as a part of our master plan. That can actually be shared later, but yeah, that's all to start with.
Okay. So ma'am, the second question for you is that owing to the zoo's proximity to the Kamla Konda Wildlife Sanctuary, have there been any interactions with the free-ranging mammals there?
That is something I think that could be something because the zoo has a compound wall, so that really isn't a case. But yes, because zoo is already a part of a Sitakonda for reserve forest, so yes, the free ranging population is also there in the zoo. So certainly there are interactions between the free ranging and captive populations, but we are taking precautions with respect to the vaccination in the specific seasons, so that there is no such disease transmission, which might be a concern for the person who's asking the question.
Okay. All right. So Dr. Bhaskar has a few questions for you, I think.
Oh yeah, sure.
Dr. Bhaskar, please go ahead.
One of that is also already answered, that in terms of contact with the wild population.
Yes.
Just curious, have you heard them whistling to each other?
The wild dogs?
Yeah.
They do whistle. Yes, that was a question by Dr. Bilal also. So I told to him that as well, that yeah, they do whistle.
Because we have heard stories of Tirupati Zoo having wild animals coming into captivity through a low motor.
Yes, so actually the same has started here. The history of wild dog breeding starts from there only, because in 1992, one male and two female, four cubs, they had fallen into our open moat of one enclosure. Okay. So then the same episode repeated in 1994. The same thing happened, and similar things happen in Tirupati Zoo also, because what happens, these are very these are part of the forest only, so the free ranging, as you already told, but sometimes the wild animals, specifically these are rare occasions, though generally we can only find wild boars or the spotted deer or sambas only, but yeah, these are rare occasions. But yes, they have played an important role in starting a conservation breeding of wild dogs. So yes, they do whistle. Okay. Your prime question.
Okay, good. And another thing is, what are the kind of research that's happening? I may have missed that in the presentation, because I'm interested in looking at the hormonal studies, if any are being done on the, especially the.
No, in fact, No, we have not done any such studies so far. Only some studies of reproductive behavior and how the pack takes care of the newborn pups was taken up into back in 2006. After that, there has not been any studies. But yes, we are thinking of those lines. And I will have a word with you. I mean, after this session, let's
Sure,
discuss
sure.
about it and maybe we can think on some strategy to study that.
Yeah, I have two more suggestions.
Yes.
One is looking at this, you're talking about souvenirs.
Yes.
There is this researcher called Arjun Srivatsa. He's a very good artist, and he's
Okay.
painted some really cute pictures of dole pups and others. So maybe if
Oh,
you can get
definitely.
them onto t-shirts, they'll sell a lot.
Sure.
Maybe you can
Sure,
cut
sure.
him something.
Sure,
Second.
please do give me his contact number. I will get it from you and we can
Yeah.
certainly do that.
He's
Thank
all
you
over
so
the
much.
internet. I mean, in terms of dole, he's a well-known person.
Oh,
Second
is
is
it?
there is this recent movie called Wild Dog. So why can't you get a lot of money from this Nagarjuna to adopt some doles in your park?
Okay,
There's a,
sure.
I think there's a
I am not
Telugu,
aware
I
of
don't
this
know which
movie. I
language
will
this is,
certainly get hold of
but some
this.
movie that came out that said Wild Dog. It's either Telugu or
Wild
Hindi, I'm
dog.
not sure. I think it's a
Okay.
Nagarjuna movie, and you can get the actors to maybe adopt a couple of these zoo animals.
Yes,
You know, that's
certainly.
a
That's a very
suggestion.
good suggestion. I will get hold of this movie first and then Mr. Nagarjuna.
No, because I think it's
Oh, that's a
Andhra
great
and Telugu
question.
in the same place, no? So
Right, so sir,
that's
I
a
think
good.
we are running out of time, so I think
Sure, sure, sure.
that's how much
We
we
can
will
discuss.
yes,
Sure,
that's
sure.
how much we can discuss. So with that,
Yeah.
we come to the end of this session, and I would like to thank the speakers for taking time out from the schedule and joining us for our 14th Know Your Zoo, Know Your Species talk. And with that, I would like to thank also the audience for being so patient and being with us throughout. And I'd like to inform them that our week 15 species would be the wild water buffalo and the Nandanwan jungle safari. So do tune in to that talk next Wednesday from 4 to 5 p.m. And Indira Gandhi's Zoological Park would be continuing their outreach campaign throughout this week. And to do follow their social media pages for updates on the different activities they have planned for the remainder. So thank you so much and thank you for joining us.
Thanks a lot to all for the
Thank you.
opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Bhaskar. Thank you, Arundhati. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Have a nice evening, all of you.